Thank you. Hope you're clapping at the end. This is going to be an interesting one. I've never combined both power play and penalty kill. I just told Aku that all in one. So my head has been spinning. I thought, yeah, no problem. I can do this. I do power play or penalty kill all the time. And as you start putting it together, you're thinking, oh, my goodness, there's so much to piece at the same time. But I am going to try to do it all in one. I'll go over that format in a second. I've been in coaching, playing a long time. Been pretty privileged and fortunate to have met spectacular people and worked with spectacular players through the whole thing. The topic of power play penalty kill today, for me, I don't expect I would be introducing much new to anybody in the room. I think we've got a lot of accomplished people in here. It's more to me about maybe we all see the same things. We all go through the same challenges of sharing my experience with it. Maybe a different, we see the same situation with maybe alternative view. But I don't think there'll be much to enlighten you. I happen to have to apologize to you ahead of time. It'll be a little bit of I'll go through the format is I'll show first to start. We're just going to go over video. I won't have any PowerPoint. So if you want to write notes about right now, now is probably a good time because I'll cover the concepts that we're going to be watching that I believe in through the video. The video, I'll start with Washington's power play in the NHL. And what I did in preparation for this was downloaded a bunch of games, Swedish Elite League games, KHL games, college hockey in the U.S., looked at my teams from the past that were mentioned with U18 players, World Junior players. I was here last year as a coach, watched some of the World Tournament special teams we had last year with Team USA to get kind of a see what the commonalities were. And it was, striking, not surprising, I guess, how similar and common power plays are and penalty kills are here in Europe on a bigger ice sheet and back home for me in the NHL or junior hockey. So the concepts, what teams are doing, what players are doing, what they're successful with. Is that a signal? Are you sick of me already? That is the fastest.
Sorry, Don. We'll need somebody here who can actually use the lights.
Did we really invite this guy up here? Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. The they're going to need it after this. I actually was surprised and not surprised. I mean, I'd coached over here plenty, and you go through the same thing. But when you watched it in volume, the concepts that I'll speak of today are the same. The best power play and penalty kill teams in the World Tournament here that we're at are going to be doing the same things that the NHL teams are doing, that college hockey's doing, that the KHL's doing. So the overlap is definitely there. I was worried, maybe I should present some differences. There's not a lot of differences, especially when you turn it from systems to concepts. And what I mean by that is you could get into playing a situation three different ways. That's a coach's discretion, but you have the guy confined. Looking at that, if I have time, I'll show some world championship stuff to tie in. Most of it's to that point, it's going to be NHL stuff, but I've cross-referenced it. So Washington, I'll start with them. They've had a power play that's been exceptional for a decade, obviously, with Ovechkin, Backstrom, very familiar names. They added Carlson a few years ago at the point. So I'll start with four or five clips from them, and you'll see what they like to do when you allow them time to set and different setups they have or postures they can be in. And I'll try to overlap that at the same time and discuss how I would present penalty kill to my team and our players over the years. From there, I'll go to power play goals in the NHL from some of the best teams, and then we'll flip after watching about 15 short power play goals to watching the best penalty kills in the NHL, which were Arizona and Tampa this past year. Were two. They might have been one and two. If not, they were the best. So modern, I think on the title there, the heading, it says modern ice hockey, power play penalty kill for modern ice hockey. I think you were trying to fool me on that, weren't you? So anyways, looking at it and thinking modern, I'm trying to think, okay, what's the difference? And really the biggest change that I could come up with in modern ice hockey is guys don't like to block shots as much anymore. So that you see that. I mean, you actually see that when you think about it, where you can get teams to pressure more. Penalty kills pressure more. I know in the NHL, there's a lot more pressure than there was and a lot less shot blocking than there was. And really it's incentive to prevent setup, which is a real key. So one note that I have to start is power play and penalty kill. It's under a microscope, whether you're a coach or a player or your best player. Your power play was 0-for-3. Your penalty kill gave up 2. That was the difference in the game. You're going to go to a press conference after. The press is going to address your players right after about how you lost the game because of one of those. It's a stat they can quantify. They see 0-for-3 or they see 1-for-3. The other team was 2-for-3, and you're going to get nailed on it as a player and as a coach and as an organization. What I present to that is it's under a microscope. The special teams are under a microscope, and when you struggle and something's under the microscope, typically the problem compounds. You get in a hole and you have all those eyes looking on you. Your players tighten up. So to me, it's really important to give your players and team enough reps to build their confidence, especially before the season starts, to know what you expect of them and of the group in those situations before the season starts. Because once the season starts, that's the fastest thing I've found to heat up, and it can compound things if you're not very effective. Okay, just a couple of notes on power play. The essentials really on a power play, and we'll see Washington again, skill, okay? Individual skill. For the team, tactics, you know, the system you play, the movements moving together, playing together, and work ethic. So obviously you need skill, you need to work together, and you need to work hard, okay? It's very basic, like I said, no surprise to anyone in this room. The best power plays, however, and it's clear as you go through edits. I love going through edits. It was a dream for me when we could finally get games on the computer. And the dream for me was I could go through hundreds and hundreds of edits of the same situation, whether it was a puck chip to the corner or it was the guy in the half wall on a power play. And where the defenseman's feet were, where the stick was, the gap that he left, did he dictate anything or not? But you could run through hundreds, boom, 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 boom. And so you see patterns, you see, patterns of success or failure. The best power plays, okay, the essentials I just mentioned, but the best power plays have a shot mentality and typically a shot threat. Ovechkin, a shot threat. Laine, a shot threat. Dumba for Minnesota, very underrated shot threat. That was one of the best power plays in the NHL till he got hurt midway through the year. But a shot mentality and a shot threat, okay? The best power plays converge. Talk about recovering pucks, that's known. But the best power plays converge, okay? If it's Ovechkin, he's converging as he's shooting, okay? If it's Laine, he's converging. Pavelski's converging. You know, you watch Kevin LeBanc on San Jose, and San Jose's power, they converge. Okay, so the best power plays converge, and when you look at the best power plays and you struggle with your own power plays, the best power plays each individual knows his role, and it's not rocket science, but they know their role. Pavelski knows his job is the front of the net, the corner, recovering pucks, banging in rebounds, and he thrives on it. So, your shooters, everybody wants to be the goal scorer, the shooter. But the best power plays have five guys that know their role, Okay. It's your job as a coach to help them understand their role and to convince them of their role, to convince them of the importance of the role. Okay. Because there are no best power plays without net front guys or without guys in the pocket, without guys recovering pucks. Every single power play in the NHL has two or three skill guys. The difference is those guys, those two. Really is. It's amazing. And we as coaches, we spend our time with the skill guys and the guys in the perimeter shooting, and we don't, the guys that stand in front of the net, block shot or tip pucks, go get pucks, and converge right there, we don't pat them on the back enough, in my opinion, in my experience, and just observation. Those guys don't feel as valued as Patrick Kane coming off the half wall. Okay. Jonathan Toews for us this past year was more net front in the pocket. He didn't need a pat on the back. That guy's as competitive a guy as there is. He thrived on it. Sure, he would have loved to be off the half wall coming in, toe dragging and taking a shot while it was coming 70, 80, 90 miles an hour past the other guy's ribs instead of his. But we put him there and he thrived on it, okay? So know your roles. I think, again, for us as coaches, we really need to understand those are huge roles. It's easy in the NHL to get three skill guys. The salary cap dictates everybody's going to have three skill guys at least, okay? And then the best power plays, they exploit seams and pockets, and they get a penalty kill running or spread, okay? And then they converge, and they hit those seams and pockets better than the penalty kill can. So simple it down in the concepts. We'll flip to the penalty kill. The best penalty kill units, teams, they dictate something, okay? They dictate something. If I'm going at a skilled player in the NHL and I'm going straight at him, he can go either way. If I move this way, I'm dictating that he goes that way. Now the guys behind me can anticipate. So that simple concept can go really unnoticed till you watch the best and the not so good. And you see the best power plays dictate something, or best penalty kills dictate something to the power play. It's easier for the guys behind them to anticipate. They got a head start for a potential kill. Okay. The next thing the best penalty kill teams do is they close quick and decisive. They know the urgency of taking time and space away from the skill guys in the other team, and they dictate. Okay, they go at it hard. And without question, number three I have here, the best penalty kill, certainly in anywhere I've seen, the World Championships and the NHL, all the hours of film, deny setup better than the worst. I would say to our guys all the time, do not give a free setup. They're not on the power play until they set up. That's a mentality. And I'd say it over and over and over to our guys. They're not on a power play. You let them set up. Now they're on a power play. Now you've got to concentrate on where your stick is, where your feet are, where the seams are. You become too cerebral at that point. We want to stay in predator mode. The best penalty kill units do that. Deny setup. And you'll see that in the film. Just some pressure points, which are very basic, we all know, just worth mentioning. You got your opportunity on the kill, the pressure, and outnumber up ice if they're lazy. That would be in a pre-scout. Entries are huge. You know, are you aligned as a group when they enter the zone? Have you funneled it? Again, have you dictated the way they're going to enter the zone? Because they're not on a power play when they enter the zone. One guy's carrying a puck. Maybe a second guy's going for it on a chip. There's usually three out of the picture. You've got four. It's a four-on-two. Make it a four-on-two on entry. Worst, it's a four-on-three. Okay? So entries is another one. Face-offs, which I won't go into. I won't go into entries or face-offs. I just won't have enough time. But that's another area that's key. Okay? Prevent setup, deny setup. Watch that pre-scout. Teams are very, you know, their habits are well known, player-wise and team-wise, off of face-offs and off their breakouts and going back for their pucks. Okay, and then rebounds, another opportunity for a kill play. And in the end, win races, win battles. Okay, I always say that to our guys. Win the race, win the battle. Get there faster and win it. Just simple concept. Stay in predator mode. Okay, don't overthink. You got to think, if you didn't win the race and you didn't win the battle, you're going to be thinking. Okay. Key now tactically, Daniel Lacroix mentioned it yesterday. We took a team for, I've had lots of teams for tournaments. You have them for 6-7 days. Even at the pro level, rookie tournaments in the NHL. And what you realize really fast is you can implement an awful lot with just concepts. It's amazing how much you can implement with concepts. In fact, the U.S. team I had, it was a lot of concepts, really diminished systems. So when you talk about concepts for the penalty kill, and this is worth writing down, I think, is shot lanes and pass lanes, okay? When it goes up to the point, or Ovechkin or Laine, you got to be in a shot lane. When it's down on the side of the walls, you got to be in a pass lane, okay? Cover the pass lane. And it's real simple. Your guys come back and they're like, what? Were you in a shot lane? Did you deny a pass lane? And you can, when you watch the video, again, you get some of the best players in the world are the worst at this. They want every little detail, and it becomes almost a crutch for them. What if this? What if that? Why this? Why? Were you in the shot lane? Because the shot went through. Or it went through a seam. Were you in a pass lane? Did you cover the pass lanes? Okay, so those are really key concepts. And then recovering the slot if you're forwards. A lot of penalty kills. You'll see the forwards get out too far. They can't F1 and F2 on a penalty kill. They can't recover the front of the net. And then it's a nightmare it's a dream for the power play, nightmare for the kill then. More on the penalty kill. F1 and F2, okay? Again, a huge concept. We'll see it. I say it, I'll repeat it again over and over. Apologize for the monotony, but I will. Get the puck to half ice. Okay, so if I'm a forward in my zone on the penalty kill, okay, and I'm playing against you, my net's straight behind me. When you decide which side to go on, my primary focus would be to keep you on that side of the ice and then push you down and funnel you down, okay? So there's times when you can't. You got to be patient, okay? That's a concept, too, for forwards. Patient, stay in a shot lane because you can't get the guy to half ice. Let him choose if you can't dictate. When he does, push him down and keep him on half ice, okay? So very big concept. Really simple to understand, extremely difficult to get your players to understand and do it consistently. Extremely difficult. They're in the heat of the moment. You know, they're about to confine a guy to half ice where he'd have to pass through you to go back, and then all of a sudden their stick goes like this, and it opens up the pass lane back or the pass lane through. You'll see that over and over on video. You'll see that on goals against. I'd say just to guess, 80%. Were preventable by the penalty kill with little details like that. So get to half ice, keep the half ice. For the defenseman, to break it down conceptually, simple, get the play into your quadrant. Okay? Get it into your quadrant. The most successful penalty kills, the strong side D, when it's in a low quadrant, is extremely aggressive, and the second D can start closing. And you can seal a quadrant. Again, it'll be a 4-on-3 for the penalty kill. You get the play and dictate and get it down underneath the hash marks into a low quadrant to the right or left of your goalie. It should be a 4-on-3, sealing that quadrant. Okay? The best penalty kill teams do that, and they do it really well. They get teams down into that quadrant, and they go. Okay? So they're dictating something. And the other thing for defensemen, when you have plays coming down, as a defenseman, they're always coming down at you, down the walls. Your forward should be in the middle in shot lane. So they're coming down the walls. You want them, if I'm turning on a guy and a defenseman, my net is this direction. I want to make sure that player makes a play below me. Okay? So now you give your defenseman a focus. So I'm not going at him. I'm going at him with an objective. Okay? I'm moving toward him to encourage him to make a play below me. Okay? And you'll see that on the film. Because, again, we want to keep it to half ice and get it down into a corner. So force plays underneath you all the time. Makes it easier for your defenseman to read. And, obviously, when you think about it, I know many coaches talk about it. When you're going at a guy and he's a shooter, if it's Malkin or Ovechkin or whatever, you want to make sure he's taking a short side shot. Okay? So you're going to go at him. He's going to shoot underneath you. You're taking the backside of the net, basically, by doing that, which means your goaltender can control his rebound better because it's a short side shot, and he knows that the shot's more likely to be coming to the short side. Okay? So those are just a couple quick and simple direct concepts that you can stick with. And you can really, you know, when we finish a game or finish a penalty kill or we go power play or we go in the locker room at the end of the period, the players all have questions, okay? And the concepts I just gave you, you can revert right to those, and it's no nonsense. It's tough to not swear right now. Get back to work. Get back to work. Simple. Were you in the shot lane? Were you in the pass lane? Did you force the play underneath you? Was it in your quadrant? Did you dictate? Did you go hard? It's all going to come down to that stuff. So I mentioned those because you can use those. Okay. Implementation is really important. We can say and talk all we want. We can run video and tell these guys just in this forum like this, but you got to give them reps. The more reps you can give them. I know I had a luxury having the U.S. team. I had some star players. I think Akko just mentioned more than 30 now that are about 22 and under in the NHL, or 23 and under. And it was a dream to have those group. I had coached pro hockey for years before, and then I go back and I know what pro hockey is all about, and I get all this talent, and it's like, I know I can get you guys to the NHL. I know I can contribute to your skill level. And one of the biggest things I focused on was reps. Okay, give them reps. So our guys got so many reps at situations, and I'll mention a drill or two that you can do or things that you can think of. So they're comfortable, like I said, that F1 and F2. You'll see in video where they're not comfortable. Give them reps. And get it to the point where it's casual. I think a lot of our reps in coaching are with us staring over their shoulder and demanding perfection. We need them to get comfortable, because in the game they don't look comfortable. So they're not going to get comfortable if we're screaming at them in practice and we don't give them enough reps. Okay? Because I've watched videos of my own practices and it looks sloppy, but the players are gaining confidence and they actually execute so much better in a game even though it looks sloppy in the practice. So, because they're confident in it, they know they have a better sense of objective. One more thing on pre-scouts. Obviously, we can get as extensive as you want on a pre-scout, certainly at the pro level, with the access to video and, you know, the knowledge on the personnel you play. I think the best is to keep it simple, quick, what they do, but really their vulnerabilities. This guy hangs onto the puck a little too long. This guy's slow moving across the line at the point. He has it on his backhand. Attack him. Push him to his backhand. He'll go there. Things like that. Real quick. And then get on to what we do. Okay? So flip to some video here. Okay, so just Washington, in this video, Detroit's a little bit passive. Okay. Anytime a puck changes sides on a penalty kill, and I will preface this by saying I could be running this penalty kill too, and the guys could be doing the same thing. So it's no, when I'm critiquing through enough experience, it's almost uncomfortable to critique somebody else when you know that what I've learned is through a lot of mistakes and lousy play. And it still is a challenge really to implement things. You can know it. It's getting your guys to do it. It's the real challenge. So here, again, if you're thinking and talking about penalty kill concepts, so you've got, again, it was in this quadrant, if Detroit's player was aggressive and attacked, keep the puck there because you enjoy a 4-on-1 in that quadrant. So as a sense of objective and a focus point for your D, you should be an absolute predator when it comes to your quadrant, okay? If you got a low guy and it's a 2-on-1 against you, you know, there's one player, and we're talking about this player here, and there was a second player where the referee is, maybe you got a little something to concern with. Eventually you won't. You'll go anyway because you'll know you got a chance to win it there. But when it changes sides, this should be an automatic. This player should seal the top as hard as he can. The best teams do it, and you'll see in the video. And this guy should be charging. It's a freebie. He's facing the glass. He's got limited options. Okay, they give them a free setup. And once, I think that's Backstrom turns, now they're going to, as a good power play is due, they're going to spread the zone. They're going to make you cover more ice than you think you have to. Okay, so Detroit's trying to keep it to half ice. I think the distance there when you're not going to get up there is a little bit high, but it leaves a bigger pocket here. Okay. So conceptually now, if you're Detroit and you're the penalty kill, keep this puck on this side of the rink. Okay. That's your job as forwards now. Keep it on that side of the rink. You'll see the better penalty kills, this D would be up, and he would be pushing him from the dot. It'd be a handoff. This forward would push him down to here. And this D would have motion and attack Backstrom right now, especially on his backhand. Okay, that would be the ideal, and the better teams do that. But again, the concept is you keep it to half ice, and you push it down into that quadrant, and you outnumber the kill. Okay, so they don't the bumper play is something you may have to address with your team. This doesn't hurt you. Not a big deal. Teams worry about it. Players worry about it. Not a big deal. This seam to here is a big deal because, again, you're not keeping it to half ice. Okay. Now you're going to run the risk of starting to run and switches in coverage. And any time it changes sides, okay, this D, this would be a good drill to do. Just have two D out there and the four other D make this play from Backstrom to Ovechkin. Back down low in here, because when a puck, I'm going to guess it's about 90%. When the puck goes through a seam and you had your killers on this side, this guy loves to go back through a seam that way at all levels. I've watched it, KHL, SHL, whatever. So, you know, if you're the Kaiser here, you got to know that, be ready that, be comfortable. Fuck, that's it. That could be a pickoff. Easy pickoff, easy read. You know it's coming. Okay. And then on this, again, we talk about concepts. So you got Oshie, okay. Glendening here is caught out, okay. The other area that we'll see quite a bit on the penalty kill, if we drew a line across the rink there, okay. Glendening needs to recover. If this guy is leaving the front of the net or the slot area, okay, that vacant area, the best penalty kill teams have one forward there. You'll see the best penalty kill teams and teams that kill plays have one forward there. You'll see teams that get scored on. This F1, who was F1, can't recover, and F2 is already leaving. Okay, and that shot, there's no coverage on that rebound. DeKaiser's playing a 2-on-1 in front. So, again, keep that puck to the half rink. So the best power plays converge better than the penalty kill collapses. Okay, next clip again. Opportunity here. If you're this D, you can charge as hard as you want. It's anticipation. It's a read for you at this point. Do you have more momentum to close on him? If you were standing still there, okay, it becomes a discretion for your player. So this is it, but we do want you to pressure that, especially because he's facing the glass. It's not sealed. Okay. Again, the best power plays, they're overload and they're willing to take pucks to the net and bring pucks to the net quick. Now, the coverage in this situation, okay, can vary from team to team. Key for me would be this guy's stick vacates here. So you'd have a pass right now, and I'm surprised Backstrom's one guy that'll look for. So you're dictating here, or at least you're discouraging him from making a pass to here, okay, by position of that stick. If you're not dictating, you're discouraging, okay? That's one tier down. But I would say he should be up on Backstrom this way and get Backstrom back under his backhand there, okay? That's where you're going to start getting technical and into details because you didn't prevent setup. So when they get in setup, now you got lots of details that you're going to have to learn, and you're going to have to teach them because this is going to happen at times, obviously, but it becomes way more complicated once you do this, okay? So just for coverage purposes, some teams will have this D up and this D down here, and the forward, you know, has partial coverage on that. You'll see teams that actually wait for Backstrom to bring the puck a little bit more. Where this D's over, it's an easy pickoff here to here by that D. It's all confidence. You should do this for your D, whatever you set up, this play right here over and over, so this D has confidence here, okay? And that's the difference in confidence. I know he's worried about Ovechkin back there, but when you start repping it, they'll start reading it easier and say, I don't have to worry about Ovechkin now. I know I can jump that guy. Okay, the best power plays have a guy that's willing to just put pucks to the net, okay? And that at any moment could have went to the net. Okay, again, low play to the quadrant, and it was a clear. Similar setup. Okay, obviously in a pre-scout, and everyone in the world knows that's the shot they want, so you're going to have to block that. Or give him a short side shot. Okay, so this D should be coming out. I think the mistake made here again could be a little bit more aggressive. But, and this player should always recover in here on this. So he's coming in like this angle, and once he gets to the dot, he's recovering with a good stick in here. So that would be sealed. They can play keep away in the corner all they want. We don't want to give them anything through us. So no pass lane through us. You can't get in the shot lane. Okay. He's out of the play, so he should be in the pass lane. And there you got to be in the shot lane. Okay, here's the one that the D just willing to put it in that. So we're just talking about power play now. Really huge. For this guy, the best power plays have guys right here, Brett Burns, Carlson, Ryan Suter. They're just willing to zip it right through here to the net and create a two-on-one right there. Okay, and a lot of goals are scored that way. Again, should have been an aggressive play right there. And the pocket once more. Again, very passive. And a low play. Okay, this is Florida finished second in the power play. I think Tampa was first. Florida was second this year in NHL power. They had an exceptional power play. And again, the concepts for power play, just shot mentality, willing to shoot, and they have great shooters. But they have a shot mentality, and they're willing to take shots, and they converge. So again, they're a great power play because they do that. willing to shoot, great shooters, and they converge. And you can see here they create a shot. So they just, you know, this is an easy concept for me. They just create a two-on-one against this guy, and then they attack a seam between these two, and they just go. You're underneath him. That's huge for the power play. And again, great knowing your role, simple, but a shot mentality. They're willing to take that shot. He expects a shot. He goes there, and you can see the converge on the backside. Shot mentality, converge. These goals that I'll pull are the three teams now. Florida, Pittsburgh, I forget who else I have, Toronto. Three of the better power plays in the league. These were not goals from the season. These were goals from a pre-scout right before we played them where it was their last 20 goals scored. And I just plucked like five of their last seven. So it's they do these things over and over. All their goals are scored this way. I didn't go through 50 of their goals and pick goals to fit this meeting. This is goals right in a row, like game after game. So you can see their habits. Okay, they're looking for a shot. They missed it. Looking for a shot again. So willingness to shoot. And obviously these guys know we're willing to shoot because we believe we can score that way. Okay. Again, bouncing puck. Look at where he's at, ready to converge. Shot mentality again. Okay. Again, this we'll see when we flip to the better penalty kill. This guy would be right in his face right now. This is a kill opportunity that's lost. They didn't dictate, so now they got to be patient. Now, when you're in this mode here, you know, you're going to protect the house and collapse a little bit. You better be willing to block shots. So you can mention that to your players. But again, nothing gets through us. Hey, what happened? Whose guy was that? Well, we let a pass go through us. Okay. So in the shot lane or deny the pass lane. And as I mentioned before, when a puck goes across the rink, NHL players, KHL players love to go back across the rink. When it's a free and clean pass across the rink, I can tell you the highest skilled guys, if they don't have a grip and rip and they didn't one-time it, they love going back across the rink. It's you'll see that pattern over and over and over. But converge, just converge. They all had a converge mentality for the power play. Again, a high roll by Barkov. No nonsense. Converge, shot mentality. Again, converge. Okay, seam, did not keep it to half ice. One forward pretty darn high. Next forward allows the play below him and a seam through him. So didn't keep it to half ice. Pittsburgh, again, same concepts, all the skill they have. But you know as well as I do, Sidney Crosby is not afraid to be right here. He loves to converge to the net. He, you know, he's down on one knee. He's yelling for tips. Joe Pavelski, the best power play, converge. They force their teammates to shoot. They want to shoot. Shot mentality. So converge, converge. Again, right across. If you keep that puck to half ice, the goal doesn't count. So or it doesn't happen. Okay, trying to keep it to half ice, trying to dictate. It's not. So F1 is caught. F2 is coming out. 3-on-2 for Pittsburgh. Crosby's hungry. They're all hungry. Easy goal. Both forwards caught out. So that's where, again, this forward vacates, which leaves a potential 3-on-2 right now. This guy hasn't recovered. That you'll see that a ton on the penalty kill for mistakes. And again, that's a concept, easy, easy concept for you when you work with your forwards. Shot mentality again. And, you know, once again, these are goals that are in consecutive games. Crosby, all the skill that guy has. You can tell the shot mentality of the power play because Guentzel is actually going to the net. You know, power plays that struggle, Guentzel would be going over here like, hey. I want it right here. Pass it to me. Power plays that don't struggle. Guentzel sees his guy has it, oh my God, he can get it to the net. I'm going to the net. I'll get the rebound. Okay. So you can see that difference. It clips like that. Grubauer wasn't even ready. Again, shot mentality goes across the rink. We did not keep it to half ice. I would say the error here, if you're looking at the kill as well, this defenseman should be a short side shot, or you block it, one or the other. You can't get there. It's got to be a short side, so the rebound goes this way. If that was through this side and the rebound went out, now it's a battle here, and that guy's coming in for the rebound, okay? So, but shot mentality, converge. Converging. Again, a defenseman that's willing to shoot. Shot. You can see Kessel hanging around. And it's hard on the coverage. Flip to Toronto now. Just four of Toronto, similar. Again, the puck changes sides. They were unable to keep it on this side of the rink. So they can't dictate yet. Now they get caught out a little bit high. Tough to push down and converge. Shot mentality. Shot again mentality. Again, a defenseman willing to put the puck to the net. When Gustafsson shot the puck for us from the point on the power play this year, we were outstanding. When we were struggling, we missed that. We didn't get enough shots from the point. We didn't get enough pucks to the net. Similar. Converge. And last one, I think. But right away, just a converge mentality. He's coming in. One more, I guess. You can see again, converge from the backside. Marner's going down. Okay. So we're flipping the penalty kill now. So we saw three of the best power plays. Now we're going to watch the penalty kill with the concepts that I've mentioned already. So all four, there you can see here, they're doing a pretty good job of saying, you know, Austin Matthews, you're staying on that side of the rink. Make your play on that side of the rink. They're trying to keep him to half ice, okay? They don't, and as I mentioned in the first clip with Detroit and Washington, when that puck changes sides, good penalty kills, no. Mitch Marner's isolated right now. He's facing the glass and retrieving the puck. Go. This forward should cut him off toward the top and push him down, and this D should push him up, okay? So you can create that turnover. And you can see how fast and aggressive they are, and they close before that puck can be settled. And again, deny the puck from going across the rink. Keep pressure. And you can see why they had Arizona had a dozen shorthanded goals within the first couple months of the season in the NHL. That's why, because of that type of pressure, how close that is to a two-on-one against. That's how they got him. Okay, again, keeping it, they're working to keep it to half ice. Okay. Hjalmarsson, one of the best penalty killers there is, again, keeps it to half ice. Little slow to move there in the rebound, but watch Hjalmarsson here. Okay. We talk about anticipate and dictate. He's trying to encourage Riley to go back this way. He does, and you can watch Hjalmarsson right away. Comes out, okay, closes on, and this would be a system, you know, preference here, but personally, I don't mind Hjalmarsson coming out quick and force Matthews to outside the dot, and it's an easier read for here. Their F2 does not vacate the slot, so you can see where Arizona's F2 compared to some of the clips we saw before, which makes it they have a 3-on-1 net front right now. A bad penalty kill, would not have confidence, would not have poise right here. They might be sliding and diving and running and panicking all over. But Arizona, again, one of the best, has a lot of confidence, good stick, great coverage, collapsing. Again, the collapse was better than the converge. Power play converges, penalty kill collapses, easy clear. In shot lanes, you can see another anticipation by Jalmerson. They're not set up. They just entered the zone. They're not set up. Jalmerson says, I'm not giving you a free setup. He's on him, and he's got him underneath. Still on him. Aggressive in his quadrant. Okay, and they get a short side shot out of it. Changes sides. So puck changes sides. Again, hard for the PK. Seal the top. So this forward really should, your job should be to seal the play from going back up on that play if you can't get there. But that pressure, again, almost a 2-on-1 again against a very, very good power play. Okay, notice where their F2 is. He was out. He's out here. He's leaving. He's got to recover. And he does. So they're in shot lanes now. Good pressure. He's recovering. Imperative that he recovers. Does. Jalmerson again jumping with a good stick. And a good kill. Austin Matthews, Tavares, Marner. Good sticks. Okay, so the recovery even here is deny passes back across the rink. So great job by him. So he's in a panic and in a frenzy. What do I do? What do I do? Deny the pass. Keep it to half ice. Do what you can to keep Marner on half ice. Recover the front. Recover the slot. And once again, in that quadrant is where you want it. It's a 4-on-3 right now. And I think this is one thing you can, you know, drill this with your team. Give them the reps. Throw the puck in the corner. So the penalty killers understand we have a power play. They do not have a power play. Okay? Very easy to see. It's a 4-on-3 for now. You need to seal that down and come across and seal that if you're the forwards. But it's a power play for the penalty kill at that point. Similar here, 4-on-3 again, clear. Changes sides, chance to and another clear and a fast break. So Pittsburgh now against Pittsburgh, Arizona. Very similar, trying to keep it to half ice. They don't, but F2 is not caught out, and they recover in here. So it's a 4-on-2 underneath in here now. And Jalmerson is able to recover. Again, it's a 4-on-2, so makes a nice soft play and an easy clear, very confident. Again, changes sides. You can see how fast they're working and trying to seal that off. They don't. Their ability here, they don't get too high above that line, okay? Because the higher you go, the harder it is to recover. So if you're going to get above that line, you probably should be able to make a play. And you can see there's still three back here, which is a real key, and another kill. Okay. We'll go, I'll flip to Tampa because there's a little bit more. Tampa had the, again, they might have been second, or they might have been first in the penalty kill, actually. But you can see very similar how important it is for this player to recover back. For this player, McDonough, force a short side shot or block it, which he does. Okay, one noticeable factor here, okay, it's tough for them to dictate right now, but they're very patient not to get caught too high. So in these situations, I would have our guys, we can't really dictate much yet, so don't give up what we want to cover. you're going to probably have to mirror the shot and stay in the shot lane without going out away from the ice, you can recover. And they do that. They do a pretty good job of that here. Patient. So patience is a thing your penalty kill needs. They need to discern and realize when they should be aggressive and when they should be patient. And walking with the shooter is a must. Stay in the shot lane when it's up top. He's staying with, that's their line A in Ovechkin, Dumba, as I said. So their pre-scout was to take that shot away. That's why he's mirroring him. But again, he recovers back in here. So it's not an outnumbered situation. And it's, again, back here, covering the seams. Again, F2 for them is back down low. And the converge, or the collapse, is underneath the converge. So this is a really big key, and I'll zip past it now. That player, that F2's ability to be underneath for rebounds, and you can see right here they're underneath. That's Hedman, the D, but the F2, the forward, is underneath for a rebound. Okay. One last clip on Tampa Bay where they really didn't dictate. It looked like they were really apprehensive against Panarin. This is not the playoffs, but it ended up killing him in the playoffs, where they kind of leave him standing in their seams. So they don't, obviously they don't keep it to half ice, which means now you got this. You got him trying to cover a lot of ice, and you got him converging inside of three guys now for a potential rebound. Slow to close in that corner. Slow to charge here. I don't know if Strawman's tired. I don't think he is on this one. But another seam. Struggling to keep it to half ice. Probably should be out a little bit. But you can see even the good power plays struggle, or penalty kills, excuse me. Panarin does the right thing. He tries to get inside. You want to give Panarin that short side shot, because that's a tougher save, and you can see where the rebound went. Okay. So these are the four goals I'm sure everybody heard of on San Jose scored on Vegas in the last 10 minutes of Game 7. It's 3-0 with 10:44 left. Some of the concepts, Carlson, willing to shoot it. A defenseman willing to put the puck to the net, and two guys knowing their role and confident, thriving in it. And then a converge. That was the first goal. So if you're looking at the penalty kill, again, they probably got, in my estimation, a little bit too high. Be a little bit more patient. And obviously the puck goes across the rink. Next one, an entry, should have the back end sealed. If you're the forward, push it down. So just slow to do that. Now the F1 is caught low. Willingness to shoot again, short side. Another entry where they don't seal the back. So if you're this forward coming in, you don't want them to pass it back, because that's your coverage. For that pass is yours. And a converge and a shot mentality, and it's 3-3. So if you're the power play, this is a guy I had for a couple years. Actually, he's his mom and dad are Slovak, and he was born 2 years after they moved to New York. The first time he met his grandmother was when we came here with the U-17 team to play in Piastini. He'd never met his grandmother, Kevin LeBanc, who still lives here, obviously. So it was a pretty neat experience for all of us to see that. But a key for Banker here and for the power play is when you can get inside this F1 and you attack, now you can look for seams and shots at the same time. So just as a concept, good power play, skilled guys know that. He made the pass across in that seam for the first goal. And then I'll conclude here with just a world championship last year, Canada-Russia. And you can see, I'll just finish with just penalty kill concept. So good tight coverage here. They're definitely in pass lanes and shot lanes to the net. And aggressive to this corner and sealing as much as they can. Okay. Now again, pass lanes, shot lanes. Now be in a shot lane. And they're willing to the corner, your opportunity to kill. So he's going, he's shrinking, he should be sealing, nothing should go up, and he can pick up that. And good pressure, and it's a clear. So you know, great job by Russia on that one, not allowing Canada to set up and forcing them to work. So short side shot, real good collapse, better than the converge, 4-on-3 for Russia. Keeping it, trying to keep it or dictate to half ice. Trying to keep it to half ice and pressure. Recover. F1 recovers. F2 can come back out. And you still have three guys net front. So as it goes to the net, it's still a 3-on-2 for Russia. So really good job. You can see, I just wanted to include that right at the end. So you can see the concepts are very much universal, or very much, you know, in the smaller rink, it's the same concepts as the bigger rink. Questions or done? Yeah.
Okay, thank you, John. Thank you for the very figurative presentation. So I have a couple questions here. So quick ones for Don before we break out for short break. So there's a question about what do you think, you've coached international hockey as well, so do you think larger sheet in Europe influences the concept that you explained here?
I can't tell you that I can give you the right answer. I can give you my best educated guess on the size of the rink affecting the concepts I just mentioned. I don't think it has any effect. I think that's why the concepts are, you know, even more such concepts. You know, keep it to half ice. I think on the bigger rink, and, you know, when you go down men, 4-on-3s or 5-on-3s, 6-on-5s, you actually don't want to get caught out. It's called bad ice. A lot of people term it as bad ice, I guess. Make the power play bring it to you a little bit more. Okay, but, again, you got to be willing to block a shot a little bit more. But be a little bit patient until you can dictate. We want to get to something we can dictate, so be patient in shot lanes or in pass lanes until you can dictate. But I think the concepts are hold.
Yeah.
Wait a second, please. I'll bring you the mic.
Okay, while we get ready with the mic, there's also a question here, so relating to sort of a practicing these habits, how do you think about using the opposition? How much with the opposition, how much without?
I would use the opposition all the time, but I'd use penalty killers against, put them on the power play. Yeah, I would just do that. So with the reps I would do on the power play and penalty kill, I'd have the killers go against killers, because you want them to get comfortable with the concepts, and you know it, the power play is going to get frustrated, and they got a different focus. So even when you have just penalty kills at one end of the rink and you're doing situations, if it's all penalty killers, nobody's going to get frustrated. Nobody's going to, you know, screw it up for you or not be invested. So I would do all penalty killers when you do all that. I put them on the power play.
Okay, so then one more question from the floor.
My question was, do you have any specific stats on directly shots to be successful?
I don't. I'm not a stats guy, because I watch so much film that you start seeing the patterns yourself. I would say the dangerous shots are when the D gets inside F1 and F2 and throws it to the net, and that high roll, attacking the net, getting inside the D as well.
But you think it's effective?
Extremely. Extremely effective. I think it should be an objective for your power play. Because it's a nightmare for the kill. And it's, again, at that point, it's a converge against your collapse for the PK. But it's a battle. You know battle's coming. And most great plays, the backdoor tap-ins, come after the shots. You know, the best power plays dictate, and they're aggressive with shot mentality and attack mentality. The power plays that really struggle have a pass mentality. I want to make a perfect play. Those are a dream to kill against, you know. And a lot of skilled power plays like Pittsburgh and us in Chicago have been very guilty of that. Thinking in lieu of working hard and attacking the net, we can just kind of sit back and pluck a seam. It doesn't work for long. You will end up in a slump really fast if you don't attack the net and create that as a, if that's not your habit and instinct, you're going to hit a, you're going to want, why, what went wrong with our power play? That's what went wrong.
Okay, thanks again. Let's give a big hand for
John Wanstrom. Thank you guys.